Alright, that's. And in the previous sutta, we had a look at some general ideas of how to overcome defilements using reflection in the right way. And now we're going to look at more specific examples of how to do that. We're going to look at how to overcome, like, ill will, resentment, irritation, these kind of negative emotions. And then we're also going to have a look at sensuality and also some general contemplations, how to think about things like that and that sort of thing. Yeah. And of course, the purpose of all this is to reduce the defilements, to clear the mind, to ready the mindfulness, and to get ready for watching the breath, and any other kind of meditation object you might want to use. So first of all, we're going to start with ill will, and the kind of classic sutta in the Gurdja Nikaya is the one which I picked out, and it is the one which kind of deals with this topic probably in the most detail, the most with very nice symbols, etc., etc. And this particular sutta is spoken by Venerable Sariputta, who is the Buddha's right-hand monk, if you like. And usually the Buddha talks about Venerable Sariputta. He said, if I don't teach, then Venerable Sariputta is the one who should kind of take over, because he is considered almost to be on the level with the Buddha in terms of wisdom, etc. So this is how this sutta goes. There the Venerable Sariputta addressed the bhikkhus, friends bhikkhus, friends of those bhikkhus replied. And the Venerable Sariputta said this: friends, there are these five ways of removing resentment by which a bhikkhu should entirely remove resentment when it has arisen towards anyone. What five? Here a person's bodily behavior is impure, but his verbal behavior is pure. One should remove resentment towards such a person. A person's verbal behavior is impure, but his bodily behavior is pure. One should remove resentment towards such a person. A person's bodily behavior and verbal behavior are impure, but from time to time he gains an opening of the mind, placidity of mind. One should also remove resentment towards such a person. A person's bodily behavior and verbal behavior are impure, and he does not gain an opening of the mind, placidity of mind, from time to time. One should also remove resentment towards such a person. A person's bodily behavior and verbal behavior are pure, and from time to time he gains an opening of the mind, the placidity of the mind. One should also remove resentment towards such a person. So that is the summary of that sutta. And then we can look at each one of these five in details. And the point about this is that these five kinds of people, they cover everyone. Yeah? So there's no kind of reason for having resentment towards anybody. That's good news. That's the kind of the good news, if you like it. So everyone is included. You can't kind of exclude your kind of that one person that you find really hard to get along with. There's no excuse for that, according to this. Everyone is included in these five categories. So I'm not sure if that's good news or bad news, but I think it's really good news, actually. And then there is a, you can carry around a pure mind. This is one of the great things about the Buddhist path, is that it's not, we don't want to have any enemies in life. Yeah? You don't really want to have anyone that you have any ill will or negativity towards. In fact, we can't really afford to have any enemies, because always it's so destructive. And at the end of the day, you're going to die, you're going to pass away. And do you want to have any enemies eventually when you pass away? Of course, there is then it's usually too late. You have to deal with those issues now. And now is a chance to overcome any enmity you have against anyone. And it's one of those things that it's such a nice thing to be able to live this life without having any enemies from your point of view. Other people may be your enemy, but you're not anyone's enemy. This is kind of nice. You have a sense of understanding, compassion, metta towards all beings everywhere. So this is the summary, and this is the way the suttas often work. Yeah, they start off with summaries, and then they have the expanded version afterwards. And of course, this matters, especially in an oral culture, where you want to remember these things. It's an easy way of remembering what is going on. So, let's have a look at each one of these five. How, friends, should resentment be removed towards the person whose bodily behavior is impure, but whose verbal behavior is pure? Suppose a rag-robed bhikkhu sees a rag by the roadside, and he would press it down with his left foot, spread it out with his right foot, tear off an intact section, and take it away with him. So too, when a person's bodily behavior is impure, but his verbal behavior is pure, on that occasion one should not attend to the impurity of his bodily behavior, but should instead attend to the purity of his verbal behavior. In this way, resentment towards that person should be removed. Yeah, very simple. It is so simple, it's almost kind of hard to believe, isn't it? That you can actually, it's so easy. All you have to do is just shift your attention away from that negative quality in the person and shift it towards the positive quality. That is what the entire thing is about. So simple, man. Yeah, and of course, if you try that, often you find it doesn't work. Yeah? It doesn't work, you try to shift it, kind of mind goes back again to the negative quality. Yeah? And the reason why it doesn't work is because you actually need to build up perceptions in your mind. This is kind of the point here. Yeah? So if you have resentment towards anything, it's usually towards people. So there would perhaps be certain people in your life that sometimes upsets you a little bit. Yeah, and hard to find anyone who doesn't have at least a little bit upset with people sometimes. It might irritate you or whatever it is. So what you have to do in that case, if you know that they have lots of good qualities as well, you have to focus on those good qualities. Build up that perception in your mind. Focusing on that again and again and again, it becomes a strong perception. And then whenever the negative qualities of that person occurs in your mind, you feel a little bit of ill will, you feel a bit of negativity, straight away you bring out that positive perception you have built up. Yeah, and when you do that, the negative perception just vanishes just like that, if you have built it up in the right way. So this is quite easy when you are with people who are generally good people. Yeah, if you are on a retreat like this, and everyone is keeping the eight precepts, everyone is trying to do the right thing in their life, trying to develop their minds, develop themselves in a positive way, also trying to be helpful to the world around them. Remember that. It is actually such a marvelous thing to actually be with people like this. It is rare in the world to find people with this quality. It doesn't really matter if it's rare or not, but it's wonderful to see that at the very least everyone here is very well intentioned. Otherwise you wouldn't be here. It's not quite as big if you have a good intention. So you bring that up, you build that perception in your mind, this perception of people who are kind, people who are virtuous, people who are trying to do what is right in the world. What a wonderful thing that is, that people actually act like this. And then if somebody does something which is a little bit irritating, you bring back down that perception. You have a little shelf in your mind, a shelf with various perceptions, yeah, all good ones, not bad perceptions on that shelf. You bring down that good perception of the people around you. You bring it down. And because it is well developed, it causes the negative perception to vanish just like that. That's how powerful it is if you build it up in the right way. You remind yourself of the positive qualities of the people around you. Yeah, and you can do this to a large extent. You can do this in your family life, you can do this with your work colleagues, you can do this with anyone who has sufficient amount of good qualities that you can focus on, build up into a strong perception. You can use this idea. And the idea here is, you know, this particular sutta talks about bodily behavior and verbal behavior, but I think the general idea is that everyone is complex. We all have bad qualities, we all have good qualities. This is just a particular way of talking about that. So whatever the good qualities are, someone might be generous, they might be kind, they might be compassionate, they might have something positive in their life. And that is a perception that you build up. But remember, to do this, you have to do it again and again and again. And one of the things that you find out sometimes when you go into solitude a bit, you go on a retreat, sometimes you figure out what your problems are. Yeah, who are the people that you're having the most problems with? They will kind of come back and disturb you in your meditation sometimes. If you have some deep-seated problems with somebody, then you know, this is what I have to focus on. This is the person I have to deal with. This is where I have to put in the effort. And then, as you do that, you change this around, you focus on the good thing, until eventually all you can see is a good aspect of that person. And at the same time, what you also do, and I will look at this more in one of the next categories here, at the same time you also forgive the negative qualities as well. Yeah, because then it's easier to let go of the negative side of things. So you focus on the good, and you also forgive a little bit the negative qualities. But the main purpose here is to focus on the good. So let's have a look at the simile here. Because the simile here is actually it's quite a nice little simile. And this is of the rag-robed bhikkhuna. Rag-robed is a robe where you collect pieces of cloth wherever you find them. In those days in ancient India, you would find cloth anywhere. You go to the charnel ground. You know the charnel ground? Charnel ground is a place where you burn the corpses. The corpse is there, you burn it, and then you usually, when a corpse is thrown on the charnel ground, it will be wrapped in the cloth. And then the bhikkhus, or maybe the bhikkhunis as well, they would go to the charnel ground and they see the corpse wrap the cloth, and they would go and take the cloth from the corpse. Yeah, and use that. Yeah, that's what they would do. But of course, you can't wait too long. You can't kind of wait for too many days, because it becomes really disgusting after a while. You have to do it while the corpse is quite fresh. Yeah, it has to be fairly new. And this is one of the stories. This is found in the Vinaya Pitaka. The Vinaya Pitaka is the content for the monastics. You have all the rules and all the regulations for the monastic community, etc. And there is one rule that is about stealing. You're not supposed to steal. This, according to this story, in this, there's a long rule about stealing, lots of sub-stories. And one of these sub-stories, this monk, he goes to the charnel ground and he sees a corpse. The corpse is very fresh, it's still warm, basically, but the person is dead. So he thinks, oh yeah, cloth, it's a rag robe bhikkhu, he needs cloth, he's kind of desperate for cloth. So he goes, takes off the cloth, but as he takes the cloth of this corpse, the corpse opens its mouth and says, "Don't take my cloth." Mark is, "What? you're dead, come on." "What are you talking about? Don't take my cloth. You don't need any cloth. You're dead. You're dead by now." And then he doesn't pay the heed to this poor corpse. Yeah, and kind of ignores the corpse plea not to take the cloth. And then as he takes the cloth, the corpse gets up. Yeah, the corpse kind of rises up. This is the original zombie. Yeah, the corpse gets up. And then he starts running, because obviously he's not too keen on zombies, like people know nowadays, not too keen on zombies either. So he runs off, and then he kind of runs back to his cube, he slams the door, and when he slams the door, the zombie, boom, falls down outside. And then the Buddha says, "Okay, be careful with these zombies." No, he doesn't say that. The Buddha says, when you take cloth from a corpse, you should make sure the corpse is cold before you take it, yeah? Because the consciousness must still be attached to the corpse. So wait till the corpse is cold, then you can take the cloth. But don't wait too long, because otherwise it gets really disgusting. You have to find a middle way in the corpse, just the right temperature. This is interesting that these rules actually exist in the Vinaya, isn't it? It sounds rather astonishing that these things should be in there, but it's there. So this was what the monks were often like. They would have rag robes, they would find cloth in charnel grounds, they would find it by the roadside, as you see here. They'd find it outside a shop that would sell a cloth. They would find kind of cut off pieces there. Or wherever they could find it, they would be really happy. Yeah, piece of rag. And they would sew up a robe. And then we have monks these days who actually wear rag robes. We have one monk around monastery who had a complete rag robe. He looked like a Christmas tree. He was so colorful. But it looks quite ascetic. I actually had a rag robe myself for the first 5 years as a monk. And I looked pretty colorful as well. And I traveled around the world with this rag robe onto the plains and things. Sometimes people looked at me as if I was wondering, what is it with this fellow? He looks really strange. But it's actually quite nice, because it's very simple. It's very easy. This robe here is a full piece of cloth, so this is kind of much more expensive in a sense. But the rag robes obviously are it's a very simple thing to do. And it's quite nice to live simply like that. Although it isn't really necessary these days, because cloth is not as expensive as it was in those days. Anyway, so the rag robe Bhikkhu, yeah, he comes along and he sees the rag by the roadside. And when you see the rag by the roadside, you press it down with your left foot and spread it out with your right foot. And the idea here is like a person. To see a person, you have to kind of almost like spread out the qualities of the person in your mind's eye. Yeah? See all the various qualities in that person. So you spread out in this way. And then when you do that, you tear off the intact section. You throw away the rubbish. Yeah, okay. And then you take that intact section away with him. And in the same way, you kind of look at all the qualities in the person. You tear off those qualities that are bad because they are rubbish. Yeah, they are rubbish. You tear them off. You chuck them out. And when you chuck them out, you take the remaining qualities in your heart. And you carry them around with you in your heart because you know that these will be valuable for you in the future to be able to calm down, to be able to even out your mind when the negative qualities become visible to you. It's a beautiful idea, taking the good quality of somebody and carrying them in your heart and throwing out the other stuff. It's rubbish. You don't need to see those other qualities. Yeah, it's not useful. It just makes you angry and negative and irritated. It won't have anything to do with that. So you chuck them out. Nice image to think about. Sometimes I know that sometimes you have this little kind of psychological techniques that people use to help you with this. And I know that one way of doing this was to write down all the qualities of a person. You write down the negative ones and then the positive ones. And you write the negative ones on toilet paper. And the positive ones you write on a nice piece of paper. Or you write on one paper and you tear it in half or whatever. So you write it all down, and then when you're finished writing all the negative ones on the toilet paper, you crumple it up, chuck it in the toilet, and flush it down. Yeah, it's a nice way of thinking about what to do with this negative perceptions of somebody. So this is what you do. You build up the positive things. You keep those with you. Keep them in your mind, on your mind's little shelf for positive perceptions. So it's a very nice image to think about. Is that reasonable? Sometimes people say, but that is like being in denial, isn't it? All you're doing is focus on the good, but we know that people don't have just good qualities. Is that being realistic? Isn't Buddhism about seeing things in accordance with reality? Well, if this is nothing to do with reality, all we focus on is the good qualities. People are far more complicated than that. And it is an interesting point, but are they right? And the point is that there isn't really any reality as such when we look at another person. All we see is our impression of that person. Two different people will look at the same person in completely different ways. One person will be the friend, and one person will be the sworn enemy. Yeah, so there isn't really any objective ground by which you can know what a person is like. They are always changing. They have different qualities, and those qualities are never exactly the same. So there is no objective reality by which we can judge another person. All there is a ever-changing reality. And this is a very beautiful way of thinking about people. One of the things that I do every year in Perth, I give a class, I go to one of the universities in Perth, and I give a talk at a human rights class. Yeah, it's actually a very nice thing to do, because sometimes you broaden out your viewpoints a little bit when you do things like that, and you do things that are a bit outside of the normal scope of being a man. So I go to this human rights class, a graduate class in human rights, and there are people from all over the world taking these classes because they want to hear the Buddhist point of view, and they invite a Muslim, and they invite a Christian, and various people, various religious backgrounds. One of the problems with human rights is that the idea of human rights is that we should all have equal rights, regardless of our background, our gender, our cultural background, whatever it is, nationality or whatever. Yeah, there should be a level playing field for everyone. But the problem for human rights is, well, how do we justify this? How do we justify that everyone should be treated equally? Because are we equal? If you look around the world, it doesn't look really like we're all that equal, does it? Some people are born in poverty, some people are born in wealth, some people are born intelligent, some people not so intelligent, some people are born this way, some people are born that way. There seems to be a vast variety of how, you know, when we come into this world, that, so are we the same or are we not the same? Right? And from a Buddhist point of view, you have the beautiful thing about Buddhism, it has something to contribute to that. Because in Buddhism, because of the idea of non-self, it means that we have no inherent essence. You aren't anything in particular. You are not that wealth that you were born into. You are not that social status. All of these things are always fluctuating. You might get born wealthy and die poor, or be born poor and die wealthy, or somewhere in between, or your social status might change throughout your life. Your intelligence changes in life, yeah? It usually goes down the older you get. It's kind of scary. And so all of these things are always, you know, changing. There is no stability, there is no real you there in the first place. And this is kind of, this is a very Buddhist idea, because once you have a soul, then there is a real you, there's something there which is the real essence. And then a comparison is possible, because there is an essential aspect of you that can be compared with the essential aspect of someone else. But if there's nothing essential in you and you're always changing, what are you going to compare? The you of now or the you of yesterday, compared to the someone else's you of now and of yesterday? Where do we take the comparison? There is no way to make any comparison. And that changes the entire kind of, you know, the way of looking at this. And of course, from a Buddhist point of view, you take it further. You take also into account past lives and potential future lives. And the moment you realize that in the past life, you know, I sometimes feel quite sure, I'm quite sure I was a monk in the past life. Otherwise, I can't really explain how I became a monk in this life. Where was I a monk in the past life? Sri Lanka, perhaps. Yeah, you think so? Think I was a Sri Lankan monk in the past life? Quite likely. Maybe I was a Sri Lankan nun in the past life. That's also possible. And once you look at life in that way, when you see yourself in all the positions of the rest of humanity, you have been everyone else in their position before, regardless of culture, regardless of gender, you know, or sort of handicap, or whatever it is, you've been in all of those positions. It makes you much more accepting of humanity. It makes you much more able to see other beings as equivalent to you in a very deep sense, and actually makes discrimination far more difficult. Instead of dehumanizing others, you humanize others, regardless of the background. It's a wonderful way of thinking. Yeah, if I become a woman in the future life, it's in my interest to help bhikkhunis now to kind of get established, yeah? Because I may have to become a bhikkhuni in the future life. Yeah, so it's only self-interest, that's why I'm here, selfishness. Yeah, so I'm helping with the Machanda, you see? It's a selfishness runs very deep, this is a part of the problem. So this is a way of thinking about this, and this is why there is no real final reality that you can say that the other person, there's no objective reality. This is the way the other person is. So if there is no objective reality, yeah? So how then do we choose how to look at other people then? And the choice we make, the way we look at other people, is whatever is in our spiritual interest. That is how we look at other people then. If there is no objective reality, you've got to check that possibility out. So instead, what is in my interest? What is going to help me on my spiritual path? That is what you look at instead. And then it becomes perfectly acceptable to focus only on the good qualities, because that is how you develop yourself in the right direction that helps you to attain samadhi, that helps you to move forward on the path. You choose that reality. Yeah, you choose what you want to see, because there is no objective reality in the first place. So this is what this is, how you justify thinking in this particular way here. So that is the idea of the Raghuram Bhikkhu or Bhikkhuni, and how to kind of overcome any resentment or anger or ill will against somebody. And after a while, as you build up these qualities inside of your mind, it becomes more and more difficult to get angry with anyone after a while. Okay, let's move on to the next one. How, friends, should resentment be removed towards the person whose verbal behavior is impure, but whose bodily behavior is pure? Suppose there is a pond covered with algae and water plants. a man might arrive afflicted and oppressed by the heat, weary, thirsty, and parched. He would plunge into the pond, sweep away the algae and water plants with his hands, drink from his cupped hands, and then leave. So too, when a person's verbal behavior is impure, but his bodily behavior is impure, on that occasion one should not attend to the impurity of his verbal behavior, but should instead attend to the purity of his bodily behavior. In this way, resentment towards that person should be removed. So here you have alternative good qualities, alternative bad qualities. So the point is simply that sometimes someone has some good qualities, other times they have other good qualities. So you have to be discerning as to what is available there in terms of qualities of various types. So the main difference here is simply the idea of the simile here is different. And here you have a simile of the pond covered with algae and water plants. And the pond here is like a person. You're looking at the person, and this person is covered with algae and water plants. And of course, the algae normally are the bad qualities in that person that you see, or you see those bad qualities. Whether they're not, this different matter, that's what you see. And then this man comes along. This man, he is afflicted and oppressed by the heat. And that, of course, is a simile for being angry, for having ill will. You're hot, you feel hot when you get angry, you're heated up, but you're also weary. Weary is, one of the consequences of having ill will. It's very often that you get tired afterwards. You may have noticed that you get really angry with somebody, and afterwards you're going to have a nap because you feel kind of exhausted by that anger. It's not a sustained energy. It is an energy which drains you after a while. So you are weary because of your anger. But also you are thirsty. And the idea here of thirst is the idea that you are trying to find a solution to this. You know this isn't really suitable, it's not really appropriate. So you're trying to find a solution to the problem. And parched is a similar kind of idea. So because you're trying to find a solution, you come to this pond, and then you sweep away the algae and the water plants. You sweep away the bad qualities of that person. You don't focus on that. You know it's bad, you know it's rubbish, you know it's useless. And then you use your cupped hand and you drink in, you take on board the good qualities in that person. The cool water cools you down, the anger disappears, and then you carry that water with you, obviously, afterwards, once you have drunk it like that. So you drink in the good qualities of other people. You fill up your mind with these things. It's not a nice image of how to develop this perception of the good in others. And then you leave afterwards. So that is the second simile. This is very similar to the previous one. It's just talking about a different set of bad and good qualities. Let's just move straight on to the third one here. And how, friends, should resentment be removed towards the person whose bodily behavior and verbal behavior are impure, but who from time to time gains an opening of the mind, placidity of mind? Suppose there is a little water in a puddle. Then a person might arrive afflicted and oppressed by the heat, weary, thirsty, and parched. He would think, this little bit of water is in the puddle. If I try to drink it with my cupped hands or a vessel, I will stir it up, disturb it, and make it undrinkable. Let me go get down on all fours and suck it up like a cow and depart. He then gets down on all fours, sucks the water up like a cow, and departs. So too, when a person's bodily behavior and verbal behavior are impure, but from time to time he gains an opening of the mind, placidity of the mind, on that occasion one should not attend to the impurity of his bodily and verbal behavior, but should instead attend to the opening of the mind, placidity of mind that he gains from time to time. In this way, resentment towards that person should be removed. So here you have a person with only a tiny amount of good qualities. Their speech is bad, their actions are bad, they look on the surface, they look like a really dodgy, unpleasant person. You don't really want to have that much to do with them. But But then you realize, you look very carefully, and when you look very carefully, you understand that they actually have some good qualities, some mental good qualities. And this is what this idea of having an opening of the mind, this actually, what it means is that your mental quality, sometimes your mind kind of settles down. Opening of the mind, this is the Vivarana. Vivarana is the opposite of Nivarana. Nivarana is the five hindrances. Vivarana is the lack of the five hindrances, if you like. When the hindrances disappear, your mind becomes placid, as it says here. When the hindrances are gone, your mind becomes calm and placid. Placid is like a lake without any ripples on it. It's a placid lake, a flat, mirror-like surface of the lake, if you wish. Yeah, so you look for good qualities everywhere, wherever you can, and when you see those good qualities, you rejoice in that. Yeah, it's such a wonderful thing that people have good qualities in this world. Isn't that great? Sometimes you think about the world, sometimes the conditionings are so strong from so many different angles and things, and sometimes, you know, it's not really surprising that people should have bad qualities and all the things that they have to go through sometimes in life and all the difficulties and things. Sometimes it's a miracle we have any good qualities. You think, wow, what a good quality is it? Well, how wonderful that is. Congratulations. Yeah. And this is the right way of thinking about this. When you focus in on these little good qualities like that, and you see the good qualities, and then you make a lot out of those good qualities, and you focus on that, and it makes you feel happy that other people have good qualities. So of course, this is a bit like the mudita practice in the four Brahmaviharas, where you're happy about other people's positive qualities in life. And then, of course, your anger settles down, and you feel very positive about that. But you can notice here, you have to be very careful, yeah? Because the idea here is like the cow getting down, and you get down on all fours, and you kind of suck up the water with your mouth. If you look a little bit far to the left, a little bit to the right, you see the bad qualities. You have to focus very narrowly on those good qualities. If you look too much on the, you know, to either direction, you see the bad things, of course, the ill will comes back again very quickly. And this is quite interesting, because what this shows us is that the Buddha, or here actually Venerable Sariputta, he puts a lot of emphasis on the idea of looking for good qualities. Yeah, to the point where you kind of have to narrow down, focus very narrowly on the good qualities. What is going on here? Why such emphasis on looking at the good qualities? Looking at good qualities, what is that? Well, what it really is, it's developing metta. Yeah? First of all, you avoid the seeing the bad qualities, which kind of takes down your ill will. Then by focusing on the good qualities, you actually develop metta towards others. So what this means is that there is a very strong focus here on developing metta. Yeah? Metta comes first. Only in the next one, the next instance, we come to the person who doesn't have any good qualities, or at least we can't see any good qualities. That only comes as the fourth possibility here. But prior to that, we really go out of our way to have metta towards people, rather than focusing on karuna, which is the next one here. So why is that? Why is there such an emphasis on doing metta rather than compassion practice? You will notice that it is actually the same thing throughout the suttas. When you talk about the four Brahmaviharas, metta always comes first. Yeah? Loving kindness or friendliness comes first. Then you have karuna, then you have compassion. Then you have mudita, which is like the altruistic joy or whatever. Then the upekkha, which is the equanimity. Always the same sequence. Metta always comes first. And as I mentioned before, these sequences are never random. It's not without reason the Buddha always placed metta first. It must be because it is the most important one. It must be the one we should focus the most on. Yeah, and this is what you see here. You have the first of all three ways of developing metta, then you come to karuna after that. And the reason for that, I think, is because metta is always positive thinking. When you focus on the good qualities of other people, you can never really go wrong with that. Yeah, it's always a positive result. You always feel good about it afterwards. In fact, you feel often very good if you do it in the right way. Whereas karuna, compassion, can easily go a little bit wrong, because compassion means that you see the suffering in others, and when you see the suffering in others, and then you want to help it out, you can quite easily spill into a sense of, you know, a little bit of despair, that the world is full of suffering, there's all these problems and all of these kind of things. And sometimes it can let you down a little bit. You might even get depressed if you focus too much on the problems in the world. So it takes more practice, more difficult to do the karuna in the right way. It's metta, on the other hand, can never really go wrong. This, I think, is an important lesson to remember that metta is the most powerful of the four brahma-viharas, and the one that is least most likely to get right and least likely to get it wrong. So this is, I think, the reason why there is such a very strong emphasis here on the idea of looking for the good qualities in other people. Okay, so that is the memorable simile of the cow which gets down on the all four and sucks up the water in it. Now we come to the fourth kind of person. And how, friends, should resentment be removed towards the person whose bodily and verbal behavior are impure and who does not gain an opening of the mind, placidity of the mind, from time to time? Suppose a sick, afflicted, gravely ill person was traveling along a highway, and the last village behind him and the next village ahead of him were both far away. He would not obtain suitable food or medicine or a qualified attendant, and he would not get to meet the leader of the village district. Another man traveling along the same highway might see him and arouse sheer compassion, sympathy, and tender concern for him, thinking, "Oh, may this man obtain suitable food, suitable medicine, and a qualified attendant. May he get to meet the leader of the village district. For what reason? So that this man does not encounter calamity and disaster right here." So too, when a person's bodily behavior and verbal behavior are impure, and he does not gain from time to time an opening of the mind, placidity of mind, on that occasion, one should arouse sheer compassion, sympathy, and tender concern for him, thinking, "Oh, may this venerable one abandon bodily misbehavior and develop good bodily behavior. May he abandon verbal misbehavior and develop good verbal behavior. May he abandon mental misbehavior and develop good mental behavior. For what reason? So with the breakup of the body after death, he will not be reborn in the plane of misery, in a bad destination, in the lower world, in hell. In this way, resentment towards that person should be removed." So here is the person. You cannot see any good qualities in. Yeah, everything is kind of really bleak. So in this case, you have to use a different strategy. You can't do metta when there is no good qualities. And this is where the idea of karuna comes in. The first thing I should point out here is to remember that in all of these situations, it is again not the qualities of the person that you are observing. What you are observing is your reactions to the other person. So this doesn't mean that the person doesn't have any good qualities, it's just that you can't see them. Yeah, you are blind, you have a long history with them or whatever it is, so all you can see is bad stuff. It doesn't mean that the person doesn't have any good qualities. That is an important thing to realize, to always to understand the limits of our own perceptions of other people. Yeah, we don't really see people clearly. We don't have a full overview of what they're like. And in fact, it's impossible to have a full overview of what other people are like. We don't even know ourselves that well because we are so complex. We have so much history. It's impossible to know people completely. And once you have a degree of humility about your ability to understand others, it allows other people to change. Yeah. If you know, okay, right now I cannot see anything good in this person, but maybe tomorrow I can. Maybe in a year's time things will be different. And you allow others to develop, you allow them to change, rather than taking a fixed position, a fixed view of what they are like. And that is so much, that already is an act of compassion towards others, yeah? Giving them the benefit of the doubt, understanding your own limits of your own perceptions, giving them the possibility to grow and to become better people. This is already an act of kindness towards others, rather than box them in and decide, yeah, you are like that, I don't have anything to do with you. That's kind of harsh. But to open up and to allow other people to grow is actually a wonderful thing to do. Understand the limits of your own ability to judge others. It's a very useful thing. And that allow people to change like that, and often they will change. So often by locking people into a certain perception, you actually make them conform to that perception in the future, and they become what you look and see them as. And it's a very harsh thing to do towards others. So this is maybe the first thing to learn from that, not to be too believe too much in your own perception, because perceptions are so uncertain and so unreliable. So the idea here is that someone who has all these bad qualities, they are like a sick person, someone who is ill, someone who is kind of moving towards their own demise and death, like walking along the road. They don't have, as it says here, they don't have any suitable food and medicine or a qualified attendant. The attendant is perhaps like the Buddha. Food and the medicine is like the Dhamma, perhaps. Yeah, similar to that. It is a thing that sets you right, makes you understand what is important in life, to live better. You don't have any of that. And this is, of course, true for so many people in our world. They have been conditioned in the wrong way, perhaps grown up in a society which is violent and with all kinds of problems, grown up in a mafia family. You're told from when you are young that you kind of to extort and be not do bad things is good or whatever. I don't know, maybe mafia, this kind of a stereotype, I suppose. But anyway, it kind of makes it easier to imagine these things. But people are often very badly conditioned in this way. You never had access to any good teachings. Nobody told you about the Buddhas, Buddhas being around and this kind of things. So you have nothing to correct you. Or your conditioning was so strong that you weren't able to appreciate the teachings of the Buddha, even when you hear them, because your mind is just in the wrong space. You're not able to kind of accept those teachings, see them for what they are. And then when you see a person like that, when you see someone who is sick like that, how do you feel about it? Do you have compassion for them? Or do you tell them that they are bad and evil? You got sick, that's really bad, that's your fault. That's not usually how we treat the sick people. Yeah? If someone is sick, usually what you say is, this happened for your no fault of your own. And you have compassion for someone. If they get really sick, you want to help them. You want to support them. You want to give them the right medicine and the food. You want to look after them. You want to nurse them a little bit, whatever it is. That is a natural reaction when someone is sick. Why? Because it isn't any fault of their own that they are sick. Yeah? And that's because sickness happens if you have a human body. This is what happens with a human body. Nothing has gone wrong when you are sick. This is just part and parcel of being alive, of being a human being. That is why we have compassion to sick people. But the point here is that someone who has all bad qualities is exactly like a sick person. They too have been conditioned in the wrong way. For no fault of their own, they have ended up with this really bad conditioning. And now they do all of these bad things. And as a consequence, they are moving towards bad possible rebirth because of all those bad things. And it's no fault of their own. Yeah, this is kind of the point here. It's no fault of their own. The reason why we tend to blame people for their bad qualities and their bad things is we always see a self in there, a reason for why they're on it. It is their fault that they are bad. But actually, this is the whole point of this non-self thing. It is not their fault. They have been conditioned this way. Once you take away the self, once you take away this sense of personal responsibility for these things, it's actually quite easy to have compassion towards someone who does bad things, because they are acting against their own self-interest. Everyone in the world wants to be happy. Yeah, no one wants to create suffering for themselves. Nobody wants to send themselves off to become an animal in a future life, being reborn as a mosquito. Nobody wants to be reborn as a mosquito. Anyone here wants to be reborn as a mosquito? Yeah, I thought not. So that kind of... It's very rare to find anyone who wants to, maybe there is someone who wants to be reborn as a mosquito, but it's very rare in this world to find that. Maybe you have a very strong conditioning in that direction or something. Maybe you were a mosquito in the past life and you kind of, something like that, I don't know. But usually not. So the point is that people act against their own best interest. They want to be happy. And here they are doing things. They think that doing bad things is going to make them happy, because everybody thinks they're acting in the right way. Everybody thinks they're doing things which will lead towards happiness, even when they do bad things. They just don't get it. Yeah, they just don't understand. They do bad things, and they will lead to the suffering in the future. While they think they're doing things that will lead to the happiness, they are deluded. This is what the sickness is. The sickness is a sickness of delusion, not understanding what is in their own best interest. And once you get that, once you see somebody who is really bad, and they do bad things, and you're going to think, good, for goodness sake, don't act like that. You have no idea what you're doing to yourself. Yeah, this is terrible. You have no idea where you're going to go if you keep on acting like that for a long time. It's going to be terrible. And something very powerful happens at that point. Because usually, if somebody treats us in a bad way, they say bad things to us, or they even act towards us in a bad way, usually we take umbrage at that. We get upset and angry. You're treating me bad. Yeah, we become very self-centered about that. It's me. It's all about me, because they're treating us in a bad way. And that's natural. It's natural that we become upset about those things. Because after all, we are so close to ourselves. But the point is that, yes, you may have to bear, you know, the brunt of some of that bad language or bad actions of the other person. But they suffer far more from their own actions than you ever do. They are the ones that really have to suffer because of that. Both in this life, because they're going to feel bad about themselves, but also in future lives, because of whatever consequences of those bad actions are in the future. And once you see that in another person, you realize that actually the only rational way of looking at them, yes, you are hurting a little bit from the way they are, but it's far worse for them. You can actually, if you get that right there on the spot, yeah, when you see that, instead of focusing on yourself, you have compassion for the other person instead. It's like you turn the table around. Instead of having this self-focus, and all this self-focus, thinking about ourselves, is so painful anyway. Always thinking about me, it is narrow, it is small, it is kind of confined. It is not a nice way of living in the world, always kind of focusing on yourself. You turn the table, you remember that the other person is the one who has the problem. You don't really have a problem, you have to bear with it for a short time, then let it go. The other person who has the problem, you turn the table, and suddenly, instead of being self-concerned, you have compassion for the other person, and a very positive feeling arises inside of you, instead of a negative feeling of feeling this person is bad. It's very powerful. Yeah, it's real. These things are very incredibly powerful perceptions. And it means that you can, in the end, deal with almost anyone in your life. Of course, sometimes we have quite traumatic experiences. We have times in our life when people are really treating us badly, and if that goes on for a long period of time, some people grow up with parents who treat them badly, yeah? And that, of course, is very traumatic and very hard to deal with. And I don't want you to feel guilty, so that, you know, you can't forgive and you can't let go, and then you feel guilty on top of everything else. So sometimes it is very hard to do this kind of thing. And what you have to do then is just move slowly towards forgiveness, move slowly towards compassion, because I recognize that for some people it is very difficult. And certainly nobody should feel guilty for their inability to forgive or have compassion. The point more here is that this is more in normal circumstances, in ordinary circumstances, when you meet someone who is difficult, you deal with it in this way. If it is a deep-seated feelings that come from deep in the past, very often you have to deal with it more gradually, yeah, step by step, and then overcome it. It may take years sometimes to overcome deep-seated problems, but it can be done if you really try and you really do your best to do that. So this is it, and it comes from the idea of non-self, that we are conditioned to be what we are. We are so because of circumstances around us. And it goes against the grain in many ways. This is why it is so hard to see this. Because it feels like we have responsibility in our lives. It feels like we're always making choices. Yeah, it feels like I am doing this. I am making a choice to do bad things. That's what it feels like. Yeah? And because of that perception of a self, because of that delusion that we are in charge, that is what often blocks us from being able to have compassion in this way. Forgive other people for the negative qualities. But once you start to see these things more deeply, and you start to understand how conditioned we actually are, how the choices we make, it feels like we're making choices, but actually, at that moment, it's pretty much determined already. It's just a feeling we have. there is this beautiful experiment that was done by a, I'm not sure whether it was a psychologist or whatever, and these are experiments that you can read about online. I think this particular fellow was called Benjamin Libet or something like that. It's something I got from Ajahn Brahm. He told me about this many years ago. And this was an experiment about choice, yeah? To what extent we have free will. And this is important to get that actually these Buddhist ideas are not just Buddhist ideas, they actually are replicated in scientific experiments as well. And what this fellow did, he was able to measure some kind of potential in the brain there, which was basically a choice being made in the brain. Yeah, it's some kind of something lighting up in the brain or whatever. And then he would find out when subjectively it felt like you were making a choice on a subjective sense. And what he found was that the choice had been made already in the brain prior to you getting the feeling that you were making the choice. Yeah, so he could predict beforehand what choice you were going to make before you felt that you had made the choice. I know what you're going to say, yeah, because I can see in your brain what you're going to do. It's kind of fascinating because it feels like we have freedom. But actually, from these experiments, your choice was already preconditioned. And this is kind of where we have to be careful. This is why it is so easy to be led astray by our immediate perception of ourselves and the perception of the world. And this is where the Buddhist teaching is so profound. It's non-self ideas, turn things around, and we look at things in a very different way. So once you're able to get this, and it's also very useful to get this with yourself as well, the more you get that you are a conditioned person, that you are subject to all the circumstances around you, the more you can have compassion for yourself as well. The more you can forgive yourself, yeah? If you know that you were just doing what you had to do, yeah, you didn't have any choice, you said something bad to somebody, but actually you couldn't really stop yourself. Yeah, then you can forgive yourself. And this is how this basically works, and how it becomes possible to have compassion for people around you. These are very powerful perceptions to use, and I would really recommend you to develop these things. Because if you do that, there is no one in the whole world, you ultimately, in the end, you cannot forgive and you cannot have compassion towards them. If someone is doing bad things, remember, they are sick, they are ill, they are mentally kind of something going wrong with them mentally, basically. Yeah. So, and let us now move on to the last person. How, friends, should resentment be removed towards the person whose bodily and verbal behavior are pure, and who from time to time gets an opening of the mind, placidity of mind? Suppose there were a pond with clear, sweet, cool water, clean with smooth banks, and a delightful place shaded by various trees. Then a man might arrive, afflicted and oppressed by the heat, weary, thirsty, and parched. Having plunged into the pond, he would bathe and drink, and then, after coming out, he would sit or lie down in the shade of a tree right there. So too, when a person's bodily and verbal behavior are pure, and from time to time he gets an opening of the mind, placidity of mind, on that occasion one should attend to his pure bodily behavior, to his pure verbal behavior, and to the opening of the mind, the placidity of mind, that he gains from time to time. In this way, resentment towards that person should be removed. And here you have the person with all good qualities. Yeah, this is like perhaps the arahant, or at least the stream enter perhaps, or someone who has very good samadhi or something like that. And so because of that, the pond is just has all this clear, sweet and cool water. It's all clean. There's no algae, there's no water plants. But of course, still, it's a delightful place shaded by various kind of trees. Still, you are afflicted and oppressed by the heat. Still, you get angry. Yeah? It doesn't matter if other people are arahants or not. You still get angry with them. That's just the way things go. You know, in the sutras, you have people getting angry with the Buddha, for example, telling him off and shouting at him and these kind of things. But in this case, it is quite easy to overcome that anger because there are so many good qualities to focus on. So you just plunge, you dive into that pond, you dive into those good qualities. You bathe and you drink, you cool down in that in the using those good qualities to make you cool down. And then the interesting thing here is that you come out afterwards, you sit down and lie down in the shade of a tree right there. Yeah, you don't go very far away. You recognize that this person is exceptional, they have all these good qualities. So then you become like a disciple. That's what it means. Yeah, you kind of hang out with this person. You realize that they have qualities that you also would like to have. You want to learn from them. So you end up becoming a disciple of this person. This is what it kind of is the what this is about. So that is what you do in the case when someone has all good qualities rather. It's kind of interesting how easy it is to get upset with people. It doesn't matter how good they are, other people still could get upset with them. And of course the reason is because of our own defilements, our own kind of negativities, our own problems. And of course we should be careful, because in cases when someone is that pure, we have to be careful we're getting too angry, because you can also make a lot of bad karma. You can really regret it afterwards if you get angry with someone who is very pure. Afterwards, why are they angry with that person? So it's good to be circumspect. It's good to reduce your anger in all situations. And then you become a disciple of that person afterwards. And this is one of the things I mentioned the other day, is that when you see someone in the world who is different, someone who is arrogant, someone who has no defilements. First of all, not having any defilements seems kind of bland. It's not something you rejoice about. But remember, there is a flip side to not having any defilements. If you have no anger, what do you have? You have full of compassion and kindness. If you have no greed, it means that you are endlessly generous. If you have no delusion, you are wise. So it is a flip side to this. There's a lot of positive qualities that come out. And it's those positive qualities that you look out for in people like that. So when you see an arahant in the world, you're seeing the living embodiment of the Buddhist path, of awakening, of all of these things. That is why they're so powerful. And you see somebody, think, wow, what's going on? I had no idea this was possible. Of course, if you've been a Buddhist for a while, you read about these things for a while, it starts after a while to kind of sink in. But especially if you meet someone like that out of the blue, it's like, wow, what's going on here? And you recognize that there's something very powerful about this. There's something here out of the ordinary. And it's so nice to see that. You think about your ordinary life, you see all people running around, trying to make ends meet, trying to make their life nicer, and never really succeeding. And you look into the world, you see people, everyone is trying to do the same thing. Everybody wants to be happy. Everybody, does roughly the same thing. You kind of go to school, you get a job, you get married, you may have children, all these kind of things. And then you die. And then you wonder, what was that all about? But this is kind of where this is often the case. What was that all about? And then you see something different. You see someone who lives in an entirely different way, who have found a real sense of peace, a real sense of purpose. When the qualities of this person are tangible, they're right there in front of your eyes. And this is what makes such a massive difference in the world. It gives you hope. It gives you a sense that there is something in this world really worth pursuing and really worth moving towards. So just seeing an arahant, seeing someone who's practiced the path a long way, is an extraordinarily powerful thing and very, very useful. And this is why you then sit down in the shade of a tree right there. And this is why the very last line of the sutta, why it says, friends, by means of a person who inspires confidence in every way, the mind gains confidence. You get confidence in something higher. You get confidence that there is a path to this because somebody else has traveled it before you. So this is what that last one is about. And the power of having people who have practiced this path before us. So this is how you overcome anger and ill will. These are very powerful things, and I would really recommend you to use these things in your own life. One of the most important things, if you want to have a successful spiritual life, is precisely to overcome this particular defilement, because it is so destructive. It destroys meditation practice, destroys our interpersonal relationships. It creates wars, basically. Let's face it. Coming from ill will, anger, and all of these kind of things. So if you're going to work with anything, of your mental qualities, this is the one you should put in most emphasis on. And as you do that, as you put emphasis on this one, then metta almost comes along automatically. Because what you have seen here, you have seen that on the one hand, we avoid focusing on those things that create anger, but that avoidance is the very fact of looking at the good qualities. And that is where metta arises. That's what I want to talk about at the next session tomorrow, how to develop metta on the Buddhist path as a continuation of overcoming the anger. But that is all for now, and we'll see you back again at 7 o'clock this evening.